Great to have your company for the first show of 2017 for Future Stars. Thanks to INC Sports Nutrition, massive show we've got for you. The Tigers at 2-0 and Prestia, the meatball, the human meatball is in. He's been on fire early. Josh Smith from the Pies and the AFL Academy coach Luke Power is going to be in to talk about everything Academy-wise. But let's get straight into the panel. And this man has been here on the earth for about 85 years. He's been on this show for about 9 now. Shift to Sheehan.
Yeah, it's great to be back, Brownie. Yes, it is the 9th year of that show. And just to reflect for a second, it was Tommy Scully and a kid called Daniel Talia that were on our first show, and they become future stars then, but then rising stars of the game. And we'll have plenty of names to introduce to our fans out there this year.
Looking forward to it. And my first coach, a little bit of a break, then my last coach. So he was a bookend of my career, and he's got a spotty shirt on today. He looks very good, Terry Wallace.
Hello, Brownie. How are you going? Well, the last show of last year, we had a look at my top 20. So, as you should do, you should go back and mark your own work. So I'll let you be the school teacher in this one. We'll have a look at the top 20, how it finished up last year. And I'll have a look at the top 5 as they stand right now.
Now, I don't know how that sits, but I imagine if you want to relay it, you've done it pretty well, have you?
Well, we'll have a look at it and see what you think, because one of the things that really happened in it was the big players dropped down a lot further than what I thought. So that seems to be a trend going on in the competition.
And I'll tell you what, Adelaide Crows are flying at the moment. Premiership contention, top 4 contention. They beat the Hawks and GWS, 2-time All-Australian and man about town in Adelaide. Daniel Talia joins us on the program for the whole day. Welcome, mate.
Yeah, thanks, Brownie. I'm excited to be here for the first show and, yeah, pumped to be here.
As I do with all our guests, I stalk them on social media. Had a look at your Instagram photo today. Most people on Instagram have either their wife or their kids, and obviously you don't have kids yet, but most of the shots that I see of you on there are with your dog, Indigo. You love your dog.
Oh, I certainly do. Yeah, I've got my priorities straight. My dog comes first and then Mrs. comes second.
Oh, yes. Hello to all the girls out there. I love my wife. She comes first in everything in our household. But let's talk about yesterday's win, and it was a really good win because you got behind early, and then just your pace and run and carry through the midfield got you over the line. Obviously, Eddie Betts kicked 3, but certainly a good effort against the Hawks.
Yeah, it was. I thought the way we come back early, you know, we're under the pump a bit, and their small forwards got on top early, and I thought, you know, they come out of the blocks and really hurt us, but we were able to bounce back and, you know, get over the top of him in the second half. We lost Josh Jenkins and Andy Otten was able to go forward. So, yeah, it was a great win.
As a group right now, you've got to think you're able to win the flag.
Yeah, definitely. I think every group goes into the year thinking that, and beating two top eight sides in the first two rounds, you know, certainly enhances that, and yeah, that's what we expect.
I remember when Jeremy McGovern came into the competition, heard his old man actually on radio, and he sort of said, well, hang on a minute, we might have another one in the family that's a pretty fair player. Mitch McGovern doing a really good job for you.
Yeah, he is. He's a really good player, and you know, come from Western Australia. He's played some footy now, and yeah, he's got a leap. He can fly in the air, and he's really dangerous on the ground. So
uncontracted at the end of the year.
Yeah. So we really want to keep him. We've been in his ear, you know, the start of the year, saying sign, mate. But he's obviously in really good form, and that'll sort itself out. But yeah, a great forward, and only got upside. You know, he's going to be a gun.
His value is going up every week. One man who was in that position last year was Josh Jenkins. And can you clear up the fact that he's only been winded and he's been taken to hospital and put on the machine? Is there anything actually wrong with big Joshy Jenkins?
No, I don't think so. I think he's the first, you know, 6'5" bloke to go down in an ambulance without a broken bone. So he's a bit soft, Josh. I think he's, you know, got on social media for everyone to get around him. But don't feel sorry for him. He'll probably play next week.
Every person that comes on this show, we show a shot of them in their previous years, a young man, and we're going to have a shot of you and your brother on this show many, many years ago. Have a look at this. Have a look at that crop of hair. Not only on Craig Hutchison, who looks 20 kilos lighter, but that is some enormous hair.
Yeah, I'm not sure what was going on there. I think my old man should have just smacked me across the ears and made me cut it. But yeah, me and the brother had a fair bit of hair there, and I'm actually growing it out now, but I don't think it'll get anything like that.
Can we just get that shot up again, just that vision one more time? And just what did you do in the morning? How did you do that? Because you've obviously toughed up the back and then sort of combed the front. Is that the method?
I don't even know. I remember it took a long time to do, but yeah, I think I just puffed it up and put a bit of gel in it and it stuck up. So,
Daniel, that's coming from a bloke who had hair halfway down his back when he first arrived in the competition.
It was a good ponytail, and I saw the other day on the news, Hanson is making a comeback. So get out there and buy their new album. But Josh Shackey, in the news at the moment, plough and shifter. Every club wants him to him. 700, 800 grand I've been talking. He's a good young player. Is he going? Is he staying? How do they get him out?
Yeah, well, look, it's going to be fascinating. And Richmond have actually been attached to him. So that'll be interesting to see how that goes. Daniel, I mean, we should be asking you because, I mean, he's a key power forward. What are his attributes? Have you had an opportunity to play on him?
Yeah, I have. I played on him last year in his first year. And I think he was their leading goal scorer. Kicked about 30 goals as a first-year player, so can obviously play. He's really strong, you know, he's got a lot of height and moves really well, and has got a beautiful left-foot kick. He doesn't miss many, so he's going to be really dangerous, and I'm not surprised clubs are into him because he's going to be a star of the,
and
of the future.
And I tell you what Brisbane Lions have in their favour is that young Josh is very passionate about going to that club. His father, Laurie, won the goal-kicking there, and so that's certainly in their favour. Now, when the dollars come in, we'll see how it unfolds, but he really wanted to play for the Brisbane Lions, and he achieved his dream by getting there.
So am I right in saying all the reports have been about Josh Shackey leaving at the end of the year and all this big money, but from what I've been hearing the last 24 hours is he wanted to go to Brisbane because he wanted to carry on that link with his old man.
And I think that's pretty important too, that that we find clubs where guys are passionate about their club. They love their footy clubs, they want to stay. And I think that's the case for probably 80% of players. They fall in love with the club they go to.
And Brownie, it seems like Brisbane is a happier place than what it perhaps was a couple of years ago.
And quickly, Tom Boyd got a million. How much is it going to cost to get him out if he does? And how much are Brisbane going to have to stay to keep him?
Well, yeah, just, I mean, look, how that plays out, you never know. But, I mean, this is a serious young player, a top-ended draft selection.
Figures, please.
You're talking 800 plus.
Oh, 800. Plus, wouldn't you like that sort of money at the Crows?
Yeah, I'll
he's already right, actually. He's a mate of Natalia over there. But Jacob Wiedering, an interesting discussion about him. I was hosed down on the Sunday Footy Show last year when I said he should play forward because he reads the ball better than anybody else, and he's been playing forward with great effect in the early rounds.
Well, I suppose where I sit on this one, Shifter, was that I was always of the opinion you draft a bloke as the key defender, you know, as the number one player in the competition, you leave him there. But they've actually been able to go out and get Marchbank and a couple of others, Plowman, to the club. Well, now you've got the flexibility of playing and wherever, and he seems as good as a forward as what he is as a defender.
Well, it reminds me of a young Nick Riewoldt back in his day. He started as a centre-half-back as a 17-year-old. By 18, he was the star forward of the comp. He could have played either end of the ground, even played on the wing. That's the same with Wiedering. He could play in any spot. He's a unique talent, a lovely athlete as well, like Nick Riewoldt. So I think, the forward line looked pretty comfortable for him in the first game.
Daniel, how hard is it at that age to play forward and back for Wiedering at the moment?
Yeah, it is, especially adjusting to AFL. You know, I've loved watching this kid come in and perform in his first year. You know, he went down back and obviously shut blokes down. And to be able to go forward in your second year and beat a bloke like Alex Rance, you know, in a round one game, it just shows how composed and how good he's going to be. It's certainly tough to do.
Yeah, he's a good player. And we've got some news on him later on in the program. So Carlton supporters, stick around for some Jacob Wiedering news. Matthew Pavlich has said that he's keen on increasing the draft age. He thinks that they get drafted too young. I would have thought when I come down and when I was just about 18, you would have thought that he probably needed a couple of years. I tend to agree with him because I was nowhere near ready. I'll ask you, Daniel, were you ready when you had that big bouffant of hair to start playing AFL footy?
No, I certainly physically wasn't ready. You know, I got drafted straight out of high school, so I wasn't ready for the move. Moving into states really tough, not only mentally, but, you know, physically getting into training and training 6 days a week. So at 18 years old, as a key bloke, I don't think I was ready.
Well, some aren't going to be ready, and we know that, and that's the development aspect of it, Shifter, but I would go the opposite direction and sort of say, why should we be restricting players? And it is a restraint of trade, restricting players. We've seen Sam Powell-Pepper over the last couple of weeks that are good enough to actually play the competition. Plus, are we giving a bit of a start to opposition sports? Because Christian Petrarca might have walked away and played basketball if he had to wait another couple of years.
Yeah, we often call that a free kick to the other sports because many of these boys could do anything. We're in fierce competition with all of the other sports around Australia. We might win the market here in Victoria with most, but we're competing with rugby and cricket, athletics right around Australia, and I think we've got it about right at 18, but it'll be a debate that continues to raise every year or two as to whether we've got it right.
I still think we're the best competition anywhere in Australia, and players are going to pick, and most do pick AFL over cricket or tennis or rugby or whatever
it is. But the only issue that I've got, Brownie, is that, OK, when we look at overseas sports, there is another layer. There's a competition comparable to go and play in. Where do the kids at 19-year-old play that is anywhere near what AFL is?
Yeah, it's a good point, and I love it when you start talking legal or restraint of trade. It's very, very interesting sort of stuff. But there's a lot of brothers and sons and mothers of sons, and I tell you what, Mason Fletcher son of Dustin Fletcher, is an unbelievable resemblance.
Well, this is a chip off the old block if ever there was one. Have a look at this boy, Mason, played just his second game for the Calder Cannons. Of course, Dustin played way back at the start of the TAC Cup in the very first year as a youngster, a 16-year-old, and that's what this boy is at the moment. He's just 16, he'll turn 17 later in the year, playing in deep defence. He's 197 centimetres. I don't reckon he's 75 kilos, so quite light at the moment, but he's on the radar, no doubt, for the Bombers.
Well, he just looks identical, doesn't he? What about Oscar Brownless? I had a chat to Billy on the way through and between shows, and how is he going?
Had a look at him yesterday, and look, he's got the footy smarts. He's going to be a player down the track. You'd call it AFL traits. Just clean hands. You see him take a mark here, a smart, then shot at goal from about 45 out, pops it through. He's creative. He's versatile. He plays half forward and on the wing. And at 186 centimetres, I think there's still a lot of growth and development. He's still in his 17th year.
Well, we're over here at the McCafe with one of the young stars of the competition. Try McCafe's finest barista-made coffee ever. Drive-through. Right now at the McCafe, they're wonderful people, but this guy is a wonderful man. His nickname is Meatball, Dion Prestia. Welcome, firstly, to our show, Future Stars. Welcome to the Richmond Football Club. And how did you feel the first 2 weeks coming from the Gold Coast? 75,000, 58,000 people, and they are a very aggressive lot, the Tigers, aren't they?
Yeah, as you would know, the Tigers supporters are everywhere. That's what I've noticed probably the first pre-season back in Melbourne and the first couple of weeks, but... yeah, we've had an awesome start, which has been really good, and we just need to keep it going.
Mate, you were fantastic in this first game. 30-odd disposals, you were tarred, you were tough, you were everything that Richmond needed through that midfield. And every Richmond supporter I speak to at the moment go, how good is Prestia going?
Yeah, well, thanks for that. But, yeah, I think a lot of talk has been about our midfielders like Dustin and Trent Cochin going forward and kicking goals, so... That's another strength of ours. I think Josh Caddy kicked a lot of goals, and I've kicked one, which is good, and shanked one 20 metres out on Thursday night. But it's just great being back and playing in front of big crowds.
Now, the power raid in the eyes here, there's a lot of coaches that get around. A lot of people that think that shouldn't be allowed the power raid. Did you get it in your eyes? How did it feel?
No, I didn't mind. It was the first time I had one. My first win, there was about 20 of us on the Gold Coast. So, it was good.
You mentioned Josh Caddy, one of your very good mates. You came across to the club together. You were best mates growing up playing football together. Did you get together and speak about it before you both decided to come to Richmond?
So obviously once the season finished... He asked me what my plans were, and I let him know because I know there was a bit of interest shown from Geelong and Richmond to him. So I think I'm not made his decision, but I think it made it a bit easier seeing that we've known each other since our junior days playing Vic Metro and rep footy together. So it's been great living together. So yeah, it's been just that bit of comfortable. Someone being there and to look out for you.
Now, who does the cooking? Because I'd imagine that you're a very good cook yourself.
Nah, I'm not. I'm no good.
Josh Caddy doesn't look like a great cook either.
Oh, he's not too bad. We just never do it.
Get Uber Eats.
Yeah, Uber Eats is the main thing. My girlfriend's there, but she doesn't really cook either.
Head down to the cafe.
Yeah, a few times after the game. It's good.
Hey, you're a great Assumption player. We're going to talk about Assumption College a little bit later, but I was on air with BT the other night, Brian Taylor on Triple M, and he started calling you Meatballs, and I hadn't heard this nickname before, and I started to ask Brian, and he goes, your nickname's... And I don't think Brian knew why you were called Meatballs, he just started calling you Meatballs, and I've said Meatballs a lot in this segment, but why is it?
So probably my first year up on the Gold Coast, might have been on a bit of a pudgy side, not as... in good nick as what I should have been, but...
Or you are now.
Yeah, well, I am now, yeah, it's true, but... I think Michael Ricciatelli just come up with Meatballs, Italian background, so that stuck, and then BT got hold of it and just run with it ever since.
Very nice work. Well, if you want to join in the conversation, if you want to ask Meatball anything, FutureStars.tv, that's Facebook. Twitter is at FutureStarsTV and Snapchat. Future Stars TV. You're going to stick around. You're going to be on the next segment. So we're going to talk more with Dion Prestia after the break. Tiger supporters, get on board. And for INC Sports Nutrition, this is Future Stars. Welcome back to Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition. Our man in the house today is Dion Prestia. The Tigers are 2-0. They're absolutely flying. Welcome back, mate. 2-0, you're flying. And I heard that your mum is an unbelievable cook.
She does cook up a storm once in a while. So try to get down there back to Craigieburn about once a week and get a feeding, but I can't go back too often. Might get back to my first year again.
So. You see the skinnies blow out when the mum cooks?
Yeah, no, she just goes over the top. There'll be five there and cook for 20. So.
And you've got a girlfriend you met up on the Gold Coast and she came there. How's she settling in?
Yeah, she's going well. So, as I said, she's living with us with me and Josh, so looking after both of us.
So how did you go with the whole trade period? I mean, it must have been an interesting period. What other clubs were you close to going to another footy club?
So I think my situation is probably a bit different. I got injured last year at about round 16 and kind of made it a bit easier just to be able to make my choice as I wasn't playing. So I could knuckle down and choose a club. So, I had a couple interested and, I was lucky enough to get to Richmond.
We've got some vision coming up of you playing on the Gold Coast. How difficult was it in those initial stages, number one, to generate the interest, number two, when you had such a young squad going about playing its footy?
Because there were so many young boys, there was about 25 of us, I reckon, that were 18 years old in our first year. So, it was all exciting. You know, we banded a new club and everything like that was great. And we got games in when we probably, if we went to a different club, not all of us might have been playing. But, we were building up really well on the Gold Coast. But I think injuries, you don't want to use that excuse, but it is an excuse. There were so many of us with knee injuries and we just couldn't get on the park all together, which didn't help us.
And, I mean, obviously you've moved on now, you're at the Tigers, but did you see the Gold Coast having the start that they've actually had this year?
No, I don't think so. I think there was a lot of expectation on them. I think they had four top 10 draft picks this year, so I think you got to take that into account. But obviously they wouldn't be happy with how they went yesterday, and I'm sure you've got some strong leaders at the club, so I think they'll make amends.
We'll talk about strong leaders. You make great mates at the footy clubs you go to. We've got a photo of you here with Stephen May. Tell us about your relationship with him.
Yeah, nice black and yellow shot there. But, I was really close with Steve. There's a bit of talk already in round two about him being out of contract. So, I love to have him at Tigerland, but he's got to make a choice that's right for him and his family.
Well, you reckon you get him to Tigerland?
A couple
of phone calls, get him in there, say, Dimmer, mate, we need him down here. Dan Richardson, we need this big fella down here.
Yeah, well, I'll definitely be in there if he hasn't signed by mid-year, but... I'm going to support him either way he chooses.
Now, Dan, we're going to retrace your journey, and BT, great for the nicknames, calls you the footy factory out there at the Calder Cannons. You know, what do they do well out there that makes them such a great producer of talent?
I was lucky enough in my couple of years at Calder to play in two flags there. So at the time, we were so close, all our boys, you know, our region was... in a close vicinity compared to some different ones. So, yeah, we were able to just our personalities were pretty similar and our relationships were really close with each other. And I think that was probably an advantage that we had over the other teams.
So the first flag, 2009. Can you remember some of your teammates? We'll see some vision of it here.
Daniel was one. Jakey Malshaw, I'm pretty sure, was playing.
Your man
there,
up the end here, Daniel, was injured and he tells us that you would have won by a lot more if he had a play.
Yeah, I think so. Oh, we might have lost it, maybe. No, we had a good team and then, I don't know if you got the next year, we had...
Back-to-back it was, 2010. Yeah, back-to-back. Yeah, and how many went back-to-back? I think you, Libra, and maybe
Mitchie Wallace, Jordan Schroeder, Brandon Ellis, who's at the Tigers, was bottom age. Yeah, Luke Mitchell, Matt Watson, Cam Guthrie. So, there was a lot come out of that one and... We were pretty lucky to have the talent that we did at the time.
And I think we see Cam Guthrie with Jordan Schroeder and yourself celebrating that victory as well, which is a great moment for you. A couple of premierships maybe for the Tigers down the track. You'd want that feeling again, wouldn't you, of playing in premiership sides?
Yeah, definitely. That was the reason why I came to Richmond. I still felt that their list was pretty good, even after a disappointing year last year. So we started well, but, a long way to go. Hopefully we can get... a few flags before I finish up.
The Liberatore name's one that's always interests myself and Brownie. Tommy Liberatore, could you tell back in those days that he was going to be the player that he's become?
Yeah, well, the way he plays now is pretty much how he played back in the under-18 days, just feeding out to me and Mitchie Wallace. So, he was always going to be a gun. It was just, I think he was always going to end up at the Bulldogs after his old man. But, he's taking his game to another level.
Hey, back in my second pre-season, I played a game of footy for the Napier Hotel in Fitzroy. They played against another pub down the road, and it was a good day until the coach over here found out, and I got called every name under the sun in his office. Libba went international and played for the Vietnam Tigers. Did you speak to him about
that?
Yeah,
I saw
that. And could you ever imagine yourself playing for the Vietnam Tigers and thinking you get away with it?
Oh, no, I don't think so. I don't think I'll be going overseas and playing. 22 games is pretty brutal as it is, so... he's a different character, that's for sure, but he's probably pretty relaxed into his footy. It probably helps him at the end of the day.
Yeah, Dion, so we were lucky enough to play at Assumption College together under the legendary Ray Carroll. What are some of your favourite memories that you learned from him, and then some of your favourite memories from school as well?
Yeah, so me and Daniel were lucky enough to play in a couple of flags at Assumption College. That's a Herald Sun Shield there at the G, so that was a great experience. And it was pretty similar to quarter days. You know, we're all really close at school. We had a lot of boarders that played who were pretty much like brothers. So, as you would know, Daniel was awesome playing in those last couple of years. And I was captain in my year 12 year, and we were unlucky not to be able to win anything then. But, yeah, it was best times of hockey life, really.
Yeah, and, of course, Assumption picked their best team ever. Let's just have a look at it and see if we can't readjust it, because we had to look down to the bench for you two. This must be a couple of years ago. I reckon we could put a few out.
It was the haircut that got him out in the bench. If he had had a proper haircut, he might have been on the field.
What an unbelievable group of players it has produced Assumption College. We rely so much on schools that are so committed to our game to produce our stars, and that's an unbelievable list of players over probably a 50-year period.
Well, Shifter, I played against Peter McCormack, and he was a terrific player, magnificent kick, but I've got Daniel in ahead of him, surely.
There's some great players on that list, isn't there? I'm happy to be on the bench.
Dion, thanks very much for joining us today on Future Stars. Good luck for the rest of the year. And one question before every Tiger supporter: can you play finals this year?
Well, the way we've started this year, 2-0, I think we definitely can. It's our goal, and hopefully we can get there.
You heard it first. Tigers will be playing finals this year. As we move on now, Plough, your top 20 from last September 2016, you've come in here this morning and you said, I got it so right, I want to relive it, I want to go through it, I am the list manager, here's your draft.
Not quite sure that that's exactly the way that it panned out, but I think, Shifter, the interesting thing, I got 17 of the 20 in the top 20, but the order was some right on the money, and others flipped around. The thing that I noticed the most was the big boys in the competition, Tim English and Todd Marshall. No one's putting the stocks into those big guys early. They're going for the more ready-made players than the bigger boys.
Yeah, they are, Plough. I noticed if your top 10 at 5 have played already in the first couple of rounds of the year, so it's the midfield types that have played, and some of those taller boys, they'll be introduced as the year unfolds.
Well, we didn't have Oliver Florent in there, but I tell you, he was very, very close. We had him as the player who was rising up the ladder at that stage. This is where I sit with them at the moment. I know Powell Pepper won the first Rising Star nomination. I can understand why people would have him number one. I just thought that Andrew McGrath, I think Essendon have got this one right. He played on Bruce and Rioli last week, had 20-odd possessions.
Tough.
At 80%. He went at 80% with his foot skills as well. So I still got him as the number one man, over and above everyone else that's there. As I said, you can argue the point about Sam Palpepper, who's been absolutely magnificent. But this guy, even when the game was up for grabs last night and they needed something late in the game, I thought that he's just, his composure for a young man is absolutely outstanding.
From one young man who was tough and clean to another man who used to be young, he was very tough, he's very clean, he's a three-time Premiership player. Luke Power is going to join us up next on Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition. Yes, welcome back to Future Stars. It's time for our newest segment today, Future Stars, the Home Buyers Under 18 Coach of the Year, Home Buyers Centre, coaching you to own it. And I tell you what, this man was a very, very unbelievably good player. He was a three-time Premiership player. For those who don't know, for those young kids who have never seen him, he was the best left-footer going around for many, many years. Luke Powell, welcome to Future Stars, mate. And we're going to show a couple of shots of you as you talk and welcome yourself in of you playing, because you were a wonderful player.
Thanks, mate. Hopefully my players are watching this because I've just found out that they tend to forget you pretty quickly, so hopefully they're all at home looking at it.
Now, do they know you? Did you have to show them your highlights? Because sometimes I show my kids my highlights.
I don't show them my highlights. I definitely occasionally tell them or let them know in some indirect way, but that's why, you know, we've got some really good coaches in our program, but two we've got in this year have been Brent Harvey and Nick Del Santo, because the players can really relate to them, because as you know, once you're retired for a few years, you become irrelevant pretty quickly.
And you're the academy coach, and just before we get into all that sort of stuff, your footy club, first 2 weeks have been pretty good. New coach, and it seems like there's some real zest up there.
Which That's Brisbane. That's the Lions. Yeah, about a few clubs.
The club you played three premierships for.
Very good. They're doing really well. They look like they've got it together off the field. They've got really strong people leading the club, and they got some really good young players. So it seems to be coming together well for them.
Luke, the IMG Academy. Take us through it. How long do you get the boys for? You just spoke about a couple of those coaches. How does the whole process play out?
It was great, yeah. Basically, the whole idea of a trip to America is to get the players for 2 weeks. We're able to train them as they train at an AFL club. We want to put them into an environment where they can train. Generally, when they're at their clubs, they have a lot of other players training because they're going through the process of being able to cut lists back, and they've got a lot of talent from all over the area going to train, so sometimes they can end up with 90 kids. But we have 36 kids over there. We run them through drills that AFL clubs have been doing, a lot of decision making, a lot of skill fundamentals, and basically the recruiters come over to run an eye over them, and they get a fair idea how they go, not only in training, but also get to know them as people and how they adapt to a different environment, which is really good.
So it just sort of takes it almost to a bit more of a pointy end, would you say?
It does. I mean, part of it is almost a reward for their efforts because, they have played some really good football. And the other part of is just to give them an experience that they wouldn't have got. A lot of these kids also play a number of dual sports. We've got a lot of cricketers, athletes, and we want to show them just what AFL football can provide them with and give them a great experience.
Yeah, Luke, speaking of those good young players, are you able to tell us about Hayden McLean? He's from the Sandringham Dragons, a key forward ruck, spent 2 weeks training with Sydney. How's he coming along?
He's going really, really well. He has a real willingness to learn, and I guess the big thing with Hayden for me is that clubs aren't only interested in the footballer now, they're really interested in the person. And he's a really good young leader and just a terrific person. He's a big key forward, he's very strong overhead. And I'm sure that, when we come to later in the year, he'll be one player that'll really stand up and a lot of clubs will really be interested in.
Well, Sam Hayes is another one, All-Australian last year. You know, got that ability to play both forward and ruck. We were just talking before about how the bigger boys seem to be going further down in the list, but you'd be hard-pressed to go past him, wouldn't you?
Nah, this kid's obviously a real, real talent. He's a pretty unassuming type kid, but for me, the key to being a really good ruckman is your follow-up and also your cleanness, and he's definitely got both of them. I went out to Craigieburn and watched him play against Calder last week, and just his ability to be able to follow up after the ruck contest and dish it out to his teammates by hand was really, really impressive.
Luke, are you able to tell us about Jaden Stevenson as well? Kicked 5 goals last week and obviously plays for the Eastern Rangers.
Yeah, he kicked 5 in that game. And I mean, he kicked 5, but I reckon he gave about 5 off too. So, yeah, that interests me. Like, in the modern game, you know, not only do you have to kick them, but you've also got to be really unselfish. And the best teams, you know, Hawthorn in the last 5 years have been really unselfish around goal. And he was certainly that last week. He's a rare talent, athletically very gifted. And his football fundamentals and skills are really, really good. So I've been really impressed. And the big thing about him is he wins one-on-one contests, which as a forward is pretty important.
Now, Luke, we want to share with our viewers a decision the Commission made a couple of weeks ago on the Murray issue. And I know our Murray Bush Rangers and our Bendigo
client... Talk us through that map, Shifter. Tell us how we figure that one out.
Well, the bottom part of that map is the Murray River.
It right looks down like Sicily, doesn't it?
Well, it's southern New South Wales along the Murray River. It's from Albury up to Mildura. Now, that area has been reclaimed as part of the draft pool. Okay, an important decision the Commission has made to take that area away from being GWS Academy area.
Who do they miss out on?
Well, Jared Brander, this year Charlie Spargo, a couple of good players, but it's more about making sure that it's very clear for boys that live in that area who have got access to Victorian competitions, such as the Pioneers and the Bushies, that they become open draft players, despite the fact they can still play for New South Wales in national championships. They'll still play for the Allies this year, but some good boys jump back into the draft pool that, that Luke can tell us about, starting off for the likes of Jared Brander, a boy from Wentworth up there near Mildura. Tell us about Jared.
Yeah, I mean, the Giants, obviously, I've had my foot in both camps with the AFL now and with the Giants previously, and I guess the Giants have invested a lot of time into that, to that area. And these two kids, and I spoke before with Daniel about clubs wanting good players and good people. These two are just really good people that clubs would really want around. Jared's a really talented cricketer. I think he's taken 50-odd wickets this year for Geelong Grammar, so he's a good fast bowler.
We're pretty good for fast bowlers at the moment. We've got Paddy Cummings and Pattinson and all that sort of guy. He needs to play footy.
Yeah, so it's good that he is, because he's a really good talent. I went up to Blacktown yesterday and saw him play. He kicked 0-4, unfortunately, if he had kicked four goals.
And,
well, it does. It's happened to us all, hasn't it? So I'm sure that in the next few weeks we'll get to see what sort of a player he is. He played as a key forward yesterday, presented really well at the ball and has a real presence, but I wouldn't be surprised if his best spot at the moment might be at centre-half back. Oh. And Charlie's a good little midfielder, really good follow-up efforts. Again, a super young man and just gets after them and very neat by foot.
He's looked a good player. I've kept an eye on him because I played against his dad, so he's inclined to sort of follow those boys through.
Can you tell us about Toby Green at GWS? Obviously, the second player to get to 100 games, kick five on the weekend and had 22 disposals and is a real gun. You know, obviously made the All-Australian team last year. So tell us about Toby and how he's fit in down there.
Yeah, he's a pretty special player, isn't he? He's probably the most consistent player at the Giants at the moment. And I know that he won the best and fairest last year, but he just plays at a consistently high level. Obviously kick five yesterday. I mean, the good thing for young footballers in terms of Toby is that he came to the club as a midfielder, played his first couple of years as a midfielder. I think he averaged 30 touches a game in his first year as a midfielder. But because of our depth, or the Giants' depth, I shouldn't say our anymore.
You would have appreciated that, because you had a bit of that in your own time.
Exactly. So he was the first one out of all the players at the Giants to accept playing in a different position. And he got on with it, and he's become really good at it because he put everything into it. Now, we have a lot of kids at the moment who see themselves in one spot. They have no flexibility to play different positions. So it's a good lesson that if your coach does put you in another position, go with it and become good at it and do it with the right attitude.
The Adelaide Pinup boy is just firing questions at you. You know your players all these. He absolutely knows his players.
Luke, we mentioned off the top that Jacob Wietering would have a team name after him as soon as next week. It'll be Team Wietering versus Team Danaher. You're overseeing this. It's the Academy celebration game, the NAB AFL Academy 20-year celebration game. Tell us about it. We're at the MCG. Tell us about some of the boys, and we're whacking the teams up here.
It's a really good initiative. I mean, Team Wietering against Team Danaher. Obviously two players that came through our AFL Academy, and I'm just looking forward to seeing these kids play against each other.
This is the best of the best.
It is the best of the best at the moment. You know, there's no guarantees for these kids, and we tell them that all the time, that you still got to put in the work. I guess they can be led to water, but you can't make them drink at the end of the day. So it'll be good to watch them all out there at the one time and see exactly what they can do. It'll
Lukey,
be exciting.
Before we let you go, you're a fantastic player, the best player of Akamatis, Voss, Black and Lappin.
Oh, geez. Put me on the spot. Yeah, that's like asking me who my favourite kids are. My favourite kid is.
Well, everyone's got one.
They're definitely great players. I'd probably put Voss and Blackie on par, and I'm sitting on the fence. I'm sitting on the fence.
I want you make it feel good. Luck with the Academy this year. Mate. You're a wonderful player in your own right, and thanks for joining us on Future Stars.
Thanks, Brownie. Appreciate it.
I'll tell you what, making your debut on Anzac Day would be absolutely amazing. This next man from the Collingwood Football Club, Josh Smith, did just that. INC, Sports Nutrition, Future Stars, he's up next. Welcome back to Future Stars. Brian C. Sports Nutrition, available at Chemist Warehouse. Train hard, live large. And this man is a Collingwood footy player and a very, very good one. He made his debut on Anzac Day after getting overlooked in four national drafts. And then he went and played on 20 games in a row, seventh in their best and fairest last year. He's had a great start to his career, Josh Smith. Welcome to Future Stars, mate.
Thanks, Brownie. Thanks for having me.
It's been a couple of tough weeks. You played pretty good footy, but goal-kicking was the issue the other night. You probably should have been further in front.
Yeah, absolutely. I think we certainly had our chances against Richmond. The second and third quarter, we had a lot of the ball, and the ball was played in our half, so... to not take those chances was disappointing, and obviously Richmond took theirs, but thankfully we've only played two rounds this year. There's a long time to go, and hopefully we get it right sooner rather than later.
Add some highlights to you, 19 possessions and 20 possessions in your first two games, so some good rebounding off half-back. Do you feel like you belong at AFL level now?
Yeah, definitely. I think being a bit more mature and getting that chance a bit later on, I was really open to grabbing my opportunity with both hands and really being bold and aggressive with the way I play. So coming in a bit later has probably helped me, and I probably don't have that fear that 18, 19-year-olds may potentially have.
Josh, Shifter will go through your story a little bit in a minute, which I find is amazing, but just what we're looking at here, it's such a big game, Anzac Day. Here you are getting your first game. How did you find out? How did it play out for you?
Yeah, it was quite a crazy week, Terry, in terms of I was obviously on the rookie list. I hadn't been promoted until I think the Thursday that the team's getting announced, and I was originally in emergency, and we just had a couple of boys fall over, and thankfully for me, I got an opportunity, and it was one of the best days of my life. I was behind Mason Cox that day, so no one probably saw me when I ran out, but it was an awesome experience and a perfect way to debut, I think, so unbelievable.
Now, Josh, you want to pick up on your journey. I don't know whether we've had a player from Toowoomba before in the AFL in Queensland. Tell us about how you got, your passion for the game, because we did see you play some great footy at underage level for Queensland, but where does that ignition come from?
My whole family's from Victoria. I was the only person born in Queensland, and played some footy in Toowoomba. And the older I got, the less competition there was. As time, so I was playing 12 on 12 footy. They couldn't fill an 18 man side. So
there he is. Butter wouldn't melt in your mouth.
11, I reckon. 11.
Footy's
just going.
And absolutely. Of course, then it didn't happen for the draft. Four drafts in a row, you're overlooked. Had you just about given up in despair?
I think so. I think I always wanted to be drafted and be a professional footballer. But I think it gets to that stage when you're 22, 23, you can't really put all your eggs in one basket, and you've got to move on and think of other avenues, which I was doing. I was doing uni full-time and working, but really enjoying my footy still and putting as much effort as I could into it. And thankfully, Collingwood gave me the opportunity.
And the call come, how did it occur? What were you doing?
I was working at the time, funnily enough. I did a morning shift that I was doing some before and after school care, and the draft was on, I think, about 10 o'clock, and I was just driving home and got an abundance of phone calls very quickly, and unbelievable.
Well, you don't leave empty-handed from here. This is the best gift lounge in the business, the Chemist Warehouse Gift Lounge. You go home with a Chemist Warehouse voucher, discover the new fragrance Diesel Bad, available now at Chemist Warehouse. Totally workwear, the King G Urban Boots are made from only the best soft polished leather. $240 a pair. Sam & Co. voucher to Sam & Co. 443 Chapel Street. They dress plough. He looks unbelievable today, plough. Samuel, the Hawthorne boys, get down there. Club Mandalay, around for four and car hire. Club Mandalay, get involved at clubmandalay.com.au. The McCafe, as they've seen over there. Thanks to Macca's at $50 McCafe voucher. Head in to find their finest barista-made coffee. At the Parkview Hotel, you can take the missus down there or anything close to everything. That is Melbourne and Steel gift voucher. Thanks to our mates at Steel. They're awesome. New battery-powered garden tools. Platform 28, just over the back here, $100 voucher at Platform 28 and Telstra Store, Thomastown, HD Action Camera. Telstra and Thomastown, 69 Dalton Road. Mate, good luck for the rest of the year. You've had such a great start to your career. We wish you all the best.
Awesome. Thanks for having me, boys.
Up next, INC Future Stars, we're going to have a look at TAC Cup round number two. Stick around. Welcome back to Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition. The TAC Cup is underway round two. Let's have a look at the results from yesterday, and there's some games on today. Western Jets defeating Calder by 31. Geelong, 77-point victors. Murray keep going well. Oakley, live at the moment, are 21 points up, so they look like winning that one. And then the Sandringham Dragons take on the Northern Knights, and the GWV Rebels up against the Bendigo Pioneers. And now that brings us to the INC Elite Performer of the week for INC Sports Nutrition. Train hard, live large with INC Sports Nutrition, and this is Judah Dundon.
We've gone with him, the left footer from the Western Jets. Overlooked last year, but was injured last year in his 18th year. Great that they can allow the 19-year-olds in the TAC Cup now. He's a bit like Lockie Hunter, prolific ball winner, reads it brilliantly playing through the midfield.
And one of our great sponsors over the course of the last few years on this show has been the Tobin Brothers, and they sponsor the Multicultural Player of the Year. And over the years, Tobin Brothers Funerals has developed experience and expertise in the funeral customs of numerous faiths and cultures and serves a broad spectrum of Melbourne's multicultural community. And the first one this year is Chankuth Jiath, or CJ, if you want to go an easy model.
Very much CJ, this boy, and he's going to be a star of the AFL. I do believe this Sudanese boy from Morwell goes to Xavier College and has started the season in terrific fashion for Gippsland Power.
And also, the girls are going around at the moment. They're in round three of the TAC Cup, and some big scores there. Calder Cannons belting the Western Jets, then the Rangers getting over the line, the Northern Knights just over the Sandringham Dragons, Geelong Falcons beat the Dandenong Stingrays, and the Murray Bush Rangers in a close one over the Gippsland Power. As we head to the break, it's time to look at the wonderful TAC Cup Youth Girls Competition, which we just had a look at. The TAC wants to educate everybody about shared responsibility for the road safety, which is why they support young women's and men's footy. Let's have a look at the TAC Cup girls.
I think I got hooked on AFL because it was something that I could bond over with my dad.
My dad actually took me along to a game when I was about 5 years old. He took colouring books, all sorts of things to keep me entertained. He thought I'd be bored, but I was pretty hooked from the beginning.
I started playing 2 years ago, probably just because I wanted to outdo my brother, and I was sick of sitting at home watching him play and have a good time, and I wanted to get in on it.
Family is definitely something that is very important for me or anyone else in the team to succeed.
Coming home from a game, them being at the game, it's just like you're always wanting them to support you during it, or else you're not going to play your best.
Mum especially has always been there driving me from basketball to footy to the next, to the next, to the next.
I've got three older sisters and they're all really supportive of me playing footy.
I've got a daughter who's 12, so I sort of see these girls as her role model. She doesn't play footy at the moment, but I think it just shows girls everywhere that they can sort of do anything they want.
Yeah, family support's really important. Without them, like, I wouldn't be able to do what I do.
After a game, they're always there to support me, and off field, they're there to support you. So without them, I guess I wouldn't have the motivation that I have to do well and strive to be my best, because they're there for me all the time.
Welcome back to Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition. Just about at the end of the show, but Rising Star, you are on the committee. Can we bribe you anyway to get a winner? Because Daniel Taylor, a previous winner, 2012, who's lit up so far?
Well, he's come right out of the ruck, hasn't he, Daniel, in his year. But 200 eligible players, 27 eligibles played first round. And, of course, Pau Pepper got the nomination then. And there's plenty of contenders for this week.
Well, we're going to push hard here, Brody. Eric Hipwood's won, Daniel, as a key forward. Yeah, you keep a bit of an eye on this young man. He looks a real talent.
Yeah, I do. I actually played on him in the JLT series and he got on hold of me a bit. He's a really good player. He can leap at the ball, as you can see, and can roost it as well. And he's got a real burst of speed for a 201-centimetre player, so he's exciting.
Well, you've got a boy at your club that should be up there as well, shouldn't you?
Yeah, well, wait, we've got Wayne Malira, who's really doing some exciting things on the wing, moves a bit like Andrew McLeod and just creates his own space and is a real gun.
And Oliver Florence, the other one, Sydney boy, playing some real special footy.
He was good the other night, wasn't he? Real good pace, kicked a nice goal. He looks like a ready-made player to be in that Sydney side already. Very, very handy.
So we're just giving Shifter a little bit of an idea who he perhaps should select.
Yeah, very good, Shifter. Well, that's about all we've got time for today. Shifter Plough, thank you very much. Daniel Taylor, good luck for the rest of the year, mate. Adelaide are premiership bound, yes?
Yes, I hope so.
And may the sun shine on you today. Thanks for joining us on INC Future Stars.